So, Lauren Greenfield, you're writer and director of this extraordinary documentary, The Kingmaker, which is all about Imelda Marcos and where she is now and where she came from. But that's not sort of the story you thought you were going to be making, is it?
No, I came in after reading an article about this incredible project of hers. Everybody knows about the extravagance of the shoes. And in a way, the extravagance, her extravagance, is what brought me to the story because of my work on generation wealth for the last 25 years and looking at materialism. She had always been a kind of iconic reference in my work. But I read this article that told about this little known extravagance, which is that she had made a private safari park where she had depopulated an island in the South China Sea of its indigenous population, kicked off 254 families, and brought in African animals on a ship, a kind of Noah's Ark ship from Africa. And that was in the 70s during martial law, when they were thrown into exile in 1986, thrown out of the country after being accused of stealing $5 to $10 billion. The palace getting stormed, them leaving in a helicopter with the help of the Americans. This island and the animals were left to fend for themselves for decades without the support of their original patrons in, you know, what was this kind of historic extravagance. So that was really what started me on the story. I thought, well, people know about the shoes, but they don't know about this other extravagance, which is so much more egregious because it involved living things and human rights, and in a way was a kind of symbol, extraordinary symbol of the consequences, intended and unintended, of wealth and power.
And did you expect that you'd be able to interview her when you started out?
I asked for an interview when I began, and she agreed. And in my work on the island, of course, she and her husband created it, so they were an important interview. But I thought that the film would focus more on these two parallel worlds. The world of this animal island, now devastated by four generations of inbreeding, no new blood. And so the animals navigating the kind of genetic problems that come with inbreeding, and also lack of resources, no veterinarian. And also, after the Marcos went into exile, the revolution, people power, allowed the indigenous people to come back, which they were so happy to come back to their island. And yet now they had to navigate living with zebras and giraffes on their land, and kind of the problems that created. So I thought that was going to be my focus. But what happened was the Marcoses, who I thought were a political power from the past, stormed into the present. In what became a comeback story, as Imelda Marcos' son, Bongbong Marcos, campaigned for vice president and nearly won.
Yeah, that's what's extraordinary. And I think we're about the same age. And I have to beg ignorance. I didn't even realize that she'd been allowed back to the Philippines. And so then to watch your film, and I mean, really, she pioneers alternative facts, doesn't she? When you're sitting there talking to her, I mean, that's what's extraordinary, how just what she's saying is so at odds with the truth. And how, as a filmmaker, do you handle that?
She actually pioneers so many things that are in the news today, from alternative facts to befriending dictators in the way our current president kind of admires other dictators, to money laundering. And, you know, they really originated what we've seen done in the Panama Papers and other places, where they put money all over the world. At one point, she talks about having money in 170 banks. Now, this is after the government has spent decades trying to recuperate that money after they were accused of stealing $5 to $10 billion. It's actually that money which allows them to come back to power. And also, as you point out, this rewriting of history, that they had a lot of as Imelda would say, bad PR in 1986 from stealing the money from martial law and the human rights abuses, the torture, the incarceration, the actual extrajudicial killings that happened under martial law. And so to counteract the bad PR, Imelda creates her own history, rewrites history. And in the beginning of making this film, I thought, you know, maybe she was, I kind of gave her the benefit of the doubt. She's a woman in her late years looking at the past from rose-colored glasses, you know, maybe making it a little shinier, nicer, but I didn't really realize that it was actually a kind of strategic history to erase the past with an eye to getting back into power. And that is what we see in the film. And first of all, the surprise that it's happening, but second of all, the even bigger surprise that it's actually working.
Well, and I think what's extraordinary with the film that took 2 years is, I'm going to call it the revolution of Bong Bong.
Yes.
That it's so interesting to see him, you know, and you can see, so tell us about that, because I mean, the film work, it's so many different stories being told so artfully at once. But the Bong Bong is fascinating character.
Bong Bong is an amazing character. Actually, so often when you do a documentary, you'll take the original material and cut it together and show prospective partners, distributors, to try to raise money for the film. And in the presentation reel that I did for this film, I actually didn't even include Bong Bong in the first part because he was so lackluster in his first interview. Now, that ends up being in the film a really important part of his character development, because he is a kind of accidental politician. He admits that he's not a world-class politician like his mother, who's so incredibly charismatic, or like his father, who was quite brilliant. And yet he's a legacy. He gets pushed by his mother, the kingmaker, into, he's the eldest son, into a run for the vice presidency, which in the Philippines is also really a backdoor to the presidency. That, make no mistake, their aim is the presidency, not the number two job. But we see in the film that he isn't comfortable in that situation, that it's not really his true passion. And yet we also see a kind of evolution in him where, I don't know if it's a corruption or maybe it's the intoxication of power, but by the end, he does seem to really want this thing that his parents had.
And I think that when you, as you said, you started thinking you were making this film about a safari park. Instead, you went into the jungle of politics. But I think what's so powerful, because it's sort of a film almost in two parts, is then the truth speakers. In your mind, you start off making this one film. You're going to go down this road. You've done extraordinary films, Generation Wealth, The Queen of Versailles. And I think maybe you thought, well, this will be a little lighter, something different, right? The safari park. And so tell us about that moment when you sort of said, well, that's not the film I'm going to make.
In the past, like in The Queen of Versailles and in my first film, Thin, which is about women in an eating disorder clinic, I've often stayed in the world of the character and not, you know, brought in experts or outside voices. And in this film, I didn't want to have expert voices, but I did realize at a certain point that Imelda Marcos, as the main character, was an extremely unreliable narrator. And that's kind of an understatement, because she's actually actively invested and involved in her own kind of rewriting of history. And so at that point, and she's very convincing. Unlike in The Queen of Versailles, where the audience kind of comes to their own conclusion, people really believe what Imelda says. And so I realized I needed a way to let the audience know what the accurate version of history was. And so I started interviewing people outside of Imelda's world, survivors of the torture of martial law, the political opposition, who was the president at the time, Noi Noi Aquino, who was the son of the slain opposition leader, slain during the Marcos regime, an assassination many people blame Imelda Marcos for. And so, and also a really important character, Andy Bautista, who headed up the commission that was charged with recuperating the ill-gotten wealth from the Marcoses, and then ends up heading up the elections. So these very credible and moving truth tellers tell history, not as experts, but from their own experience. I felt like it was really important in a time when of fake news and when we're getting disinformation to have eyewitnesses. And so instead of experts, these are people who are first person accounts and are able to really provide an accurate truth-telling foil to the stories that Imelda Marcos weaves.
And I think your film, for somebody like me, and you know, we sort of, she's the punchline, you know, from the shoes. And to really get the sense of that this was not just sort of the glamorous first lady. This was somebody who was intimately involved with the machinations of her husband. And this idea that now, as she nears 90, she's, you know, standing trial for some of her crimes. And talk about that, those moments where she's talking about her, the crimes of which she's accused and how.
Yeah, I mean, she'll, so, in a way, the film does start out light because I think that is our memory of Imelda Marcos. But what Andy Bautista says, who was the one in charge of going after the ill-gotten wealth, he says the shoes are a distraction. And what he means is they're an intentional distraction. They're kind of misdirect because, you know, if it's somebody who's vain or indulgent or maybe the kind of feminine weakness or feminine vanity, that's not very threatening. Instead, we see a more Machiavellian power player. And I think that is the surprise. Like you said, there were many cases, criminal cases and civil cases against them, but none of them have stuck. That's the amazing thing, is she is Teflon in a way that we often talk about our current president being Teflon. Now, that Teflon is also a function of corruption and the money that can be funneled to judges and, you know, other people. And so despite all of these cases, there's never been any jail time by any of people in the Marcos family. And out of the $5 to $10 billion that they stole, and that was $5 to $10 billion in 1986, so greatly appreciated dollars, only $4 billion has been recuperated. And that's really, you know, what allows them to kind of come back. And we see this progression with the untruths. So it begins with something fairly innocuous. She says, "My marriage was the greatest ever." And then we hear about the affairs in her marriage and that she actually cried at the time. So we know it wasn't perfect. But what those untruths eventually build to is Imelda saying martial law was the most wonderful time for the Philippines. Martial law was the time when thousands were tortured, killed, incarcerated. And martial law is what we hear, these very moving stories of by the torture survivors of what happened to them in martial law. So for her to say martial law was a wonderful time is the most kind of egregious erasing of history. But what's even more shocking is when we hear from school children repeating the same myths about martial law, that it was a good time, and we realize how successful this rewriting of history has been.
And including with the current president, who she's closely aligned with. And so do you sort of, with your film, such an important film, for us in America to see, but in terms of in the Philippines? I mean, will this president allow your film to be seen there?
I don't know. We really hope so, because history and an accurate view of history is so important in the Philippines right now. It's like so many of the things that's going on in our country with using disinformation, specifically using disinformation through social media to impact elections, has been even more powerful in the Philippines. In fact, Cambridge Analytica was involved. And when you have a population that many people who are uneducated and many people who are getting their news from social media as their primary source, and what the Marcos has discovered was there was a huge proportion of the electorate that was too young to remember 1986 and the sins of martial law. So this was a very powerful combination to support the Marcoses. And of course, now we have another authoritarian president, Duterte, who is also responsible for many thousands of extrajudicial killings and threatening democracy in many of the same ways that Marcos did, whether it's the independence of the judiciary or shutting down free press, critiquing the opposition, all reasons that we're hopeful that the movie will be shown, but we don't know yet because he has not embraced critical work.
Well, I like to think that, you know, when awards are given to films, you know, that gives them a certain amount of attention and cachet, and perhaps that's the sort of thing that the Kingmaker will have going forward. Listen, thank you so much for making this film and taking the time to talk to us. It's such a wonderful film, and I'm so impressed with your filmmaking, and like I said, the fact that you sort of started down one road and went completely where it took you is really a credit to you, and I can't wait to see what you're doing next.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
Bye-bye.